Are we being simulated? This is a question that was once considered by the 17th century philosopher René Descartes, who thought that the world we happen to be living in is a delusion of dreams constructed by the demon himself. Hello, darkness, my old friend. In a more recent time, the philosopher Nick Bostrom formulated an argument proposing that we might be living inside a computer simulation. This was in a time when most computers looked like this. Mario Kart Double Dash was brand spanking new, the Nokia Brick was considered state of the art, and even this bad boy saw the light of day that year. Now, only 19 years later, technology has advanced quite a bit. This guy with his $600 billion company is working viciously trying to create a metaverse or virtual reality. Video game graphics are becoming more and more realistic, and many people nowadays already seem to be spending most of their time within the boundaries of a small flat screen. So it is safe to say that as time progresses, so does technology and computer capabilities. So much so that it seems as if it is only a matter of time before we're able to create a computer-driven virtual reality that is so realistic that it is indistinguishable from our world. Hence making the question, are we in fact ourselves living within such a computer-simulated reality even more relevant?
The strongest argument for us being in a simulation, probably being in a simulation, I think is the following. 40 years ago, we had Pong, like two rectangles and a dot. That was what games were. Now, 40 years later, we have photorealistic 3D simulations with millions of people playing simultaneously, and it's getting better every year. And soon we'll have virtual reality, augmented reality. If you assume any rate of improvement at all, then the games will become indistinguishable from reality. Even if that rate of advancement drops by 1,000 from what it is right now, then you just say, okay, well let's imagine it's 10,000 years in the future, which is nothing in the evolutionary scale. So given that we're clearly on a trajectory to have games that are indistinguishable from reality, and those games could be played on any set-top box or on a PC or whatever, and there would probably be billions of such computers or set-top boxes, it would seem to follow that the odds that we're in base reality is one in billions.
Interesting. The argument that Elon is presenting here is similar to what Nick Bostrom described as proposition number 3 in his article published in 2003. But what is missing from Elon's argument is what Bostrom described as proposition number 1 and 2. The first of which is whether or not our species will go extinct before reaching a point where we are able to make a simulation that is indistinguishable from reality. And this is not an explanation made out of thin air. The same explanation can, for example, be used in the Fermi paradox, which refers to why we haven't come across or seen any evidence of extraterrestrial life, simply because it might be the nature of intelligent life to destroy itself. And just by looking at how we conduct ourselves, it is certainly a possibility, and therefore we and perhaps other intelligent species might never reach a point where making a real-life simulation is possible. And even if we or other intelligent beings don't self-destruct, then the destruction might be caused by other, more natural reasons. I guess for us, only time will tell. Okay, so proposition number 2. If humanity does get to a post-human civilization stage, then that civilization might still not run a significant number of real-world simulations, if any. It is within this proposition we can find the strongest arguments against us being simulated. We find these arguments when considering what the purpose of simulating a reality like ours would be, how these simulations would then be handled, produced, and distributed, and perhaps also if it is even possible to create a simulation identical to the world we live in. In terms of whether it is possible, the strongest argument against the simulation hypothesis is found when considering our human consciousness. If we assume that the world we live in, and yourself included, is nothing but a very realistic simulation, then it would mean that your consciousness is also a simulation. But in order to simulate consciousness, one would have to understand the nature of consciousness. But we don't, and we cannot just assume that a post-human civilization will understand it, let alone simulate it. Therefore, if a post-human civilization would ever simulate reality, it wouldn't necessarily follow that consciousness within the simulation would be born. But this argument mostly applies if we assume that we are being simulated rather than being inside a simulation. We will get to that later. For the remainder of this video, we will assume that it is possible to simulate consciousness exactly identical to how you are experiencing it right now. Okay, let's hear what Neil deGrasse Tyson has to say.
You look at our computing power today, and you say, I have the power to program a world inside of a computer. Well, imagine in the future where you have even more power than that, and you can create characters that have, for example, free will, or their own perception of free will. So this is a world, and I program in the laws that govern that world. That world will have its own laws of physics and chemistry and biology. Now, you're a character in that world, and you think you have free will, and you say, I want to invent a computer. So you do. Hey, I want to create a world in my computer. And then that world creates a world in its computer. And then you have simulations all the way down. So now you lay out all these universes and throw a dart. Which of these universes are you most likely to hit? The original one that started it, or the countless simulations, the daughter simulations that unfolded thereafter? You're going to hit one of the simulations.
Okay, so Neil and Elon propose two different scenarios in which a myriad of simulated worlds would be created. Elon talks about simulated worlds taking place in billions of set-top boxes and or computers, whereas Neil proposes that only one simulation is needed in order to produce an infinite amount of other simulations. The so-called simulation within a simulation within a simulation argument. Let's begin with that one. Here we have a base reality, which is the reality that is actually real, therefore non-simulated. Now, somehow the intelligent beings within base reality produce a simulated world that is indistinguishable from their reality. And then within this simulated world, the intelligent and simulated beings find their own way to produce a simulation of their reality. And so this process just continues on and on again. Let's just say 9 times, so we have a total of 10 layers of realities. Using this logic, our odds would then be 1/10 chance of us being in base reality, right? Not quite. And why? Well, because we are not in a world where we have been able to produce a simulation that is indistinguishable from our world. And because of this, we are unable to be living within one of the simulations where that has taken place. Therefore, with this logic, we can only be within base reality or the outermost simulation where they haven't yet created their own simulation. Therefore, 50-50.
But wait! There's more!
We might also have to consider the possibility that some of these simulations are creating multiple simulations, or daughter simulations like Neil said, which means exponential growth in simulations, and as a result of this, a numerous amount of simulated worlds in the outer layers of simulated realities, which might be where we are.
Hello, darkness.
But there is one consideration that counts against this multi-level simulation hypothesis, which is that the computational cost for the base-level simulators would have to be very great and increasing each time a new layer of simulated reality is added on top of another. Simulating even a single post-human civilization might be prohibitively costly. If so, then we should expect our simulation to be terminated when we are about to become post-human. But before we give up entirely and our perception of reality goes to shit, then there are still some other factors we have to consider that might indicate that we are not being simulated. For instance, what the purpose of the first ever simulated reality might be, because one thing is certain, it all depends on what takes place in base reality. Both Elon and Neil imagine that the purpose of the simulations might be in the form of a computer game. Neil even goes as far as saying,
it's hard to argue against the possibility that all of us are not just the creation of some kid in a parent's basement programming up a world for their own entertainment.
So let's start with the video game or entertainment simulation like the one Elon Musk proposes, where these simulations would then be distributed to millions or perhaps even billions of consumers. With a real-life computer game simulation, the nature of your existence can be summed up in 3 possibilities. Number 1, you are a player. This is the least likely possibility because otherwise you would probably be aware of it. you would know that this isn't real life and that you live another life in another reality. Perhaps life is a
kid in a parent's basement.
If you are a player and you are not aware of it, it would mean that when the
kid
starts playing the game, all sense of reality is lost while playing the game. Exiting the game independently might not even be possible in this scenario, which can make it kind of a hard sell.
One world, one person, with endless opportunities. For only 4,999 schmeckles with a monthly subscription of 999 schmeckles, you can enjoy a completely new life with zero consequence. Live, learn, love and play.
When playing this game on this platform, all sense of reality will be lost. All you have ever known will be completely forgotten, including your own ego, your family, your friends, your loved ones. All memory will be completely lost somewhere we don't know yet. Treatment by a psychologist as a result of playing this game is not included.
Like I said, a hard sell, and therefore doesn't seem very likely. So another possibility that presents itself is that you might be a puppet controlled by a puppet master. This would then mean that you are not the author of your own thoughts and actions. The illusion of free will planted in your mind is simply a
kid in a parent's basement
toying with your mind. The third and final possibility is that you are a puppet being controlled by absolutely no one besides your own artificial intelligence. You are merely a sheep inside this empty simulated world with the sole purpose of being decoration for some
kid in a parent's basement.
Hello, dark.
So this lays the foundation for the video game or entertainment purpose simulation. Now, I would like to propose why I don't think this video game or entertainment purpose seems very likely. To do this, we will have to try to imagine how any post-human civilization might think. In Bostrom's paper, he recognizes that there might be an ethical prohibition against running ancestor simulations because of the suffering that is inflicted on the inhabitants inside of the simulation. This might leave you thinking, well, people who live in a post-human civilization don't have any ethics, right? They're so full of themselves. Well, chances are that such a civilization would have strong ethics, because they would have to be living within a very functional society, and one element that sustains a functional society is practicing ethics. So while it might not prevent them from running lifelike simulations, it might prevent them from running billions of them where the inhabitants inside are actually and unnecessarily experiencing consciousness and pain, as we do.
Hello,
Bostrom also proposes that post-human civilizations might develop in a direction where they lose the desires to run ancestor simulations, and maybe post-humans may even regard such simulations as merely a very inefficient way of getting pleasure, which can be obtained much more cheaply and easily by direct stimulation of the brain's reward centers. So while a real-life game simulation sounds like real fun to us, it might be super boring for any post-human civilization, and therefore they might not even bother producing it, let alone distribute it to millions of consumers, because there might not even be a market for it. So if not entertainment, then what? Let's imagine that we are at base reality, and we are a long way into the future in a more advanced society. At some point in the highest hierarchy of that society, they will come to realize that within a relative period of time, they will be able to create a simulation that is indistinguishable from the real world. So what would they do with this new technology? Would they mass produce it and make it available on some kind of free market? Or would they take advantage of it and use it for political and societal benefits? My guess is the second one. With this kind of technology, it would be possible to conduct experiments on individuals, groups, communities, and even nations within the framework of a computer screen, and the expenses for those experiments would only amount to what it would cost to keep the machine running. It would be a groundbreaking tool for political science. Of course, it wouldn't be possible to make a simulated society that is completely identical to that of their own, but they would make one that is similar and perhaps more simple. Like our world. They would be able to test all kinds of new policies in different kinds of contexts and environments before implementing them themselves, and by doing this, they minimize the risk they take when implementing new and innovative initiatives. They could run the same test over thousands of times with small changes to further increase the statistical significance level, and they could even enter the simulation themselves and experience what is going on inside the experiment firsthand, thereby using a more qualitative approach in gaining knowledge. They might even be able to conduct an experiment where the inhabitants inside are confronted with the fact that they are being simulated. Perhaps a new video game is introduced and distributed to them.
One world, one person.
The base reality scientist could then monitor how human behavior would change, how the masses would respond to such a drastic change in their perception of the nature of their existence. And if it all goes to shit, well, then the base reality decision makers might decide to never let such technology become public. Another factor that might prevent the base level decision makers from sharing this kind of technology is if there are two or more opposing superpower nations or areas in their world, because they would then have no interest in sharing this type of technology with an opposing power, because possessing such technology could easily change the power dynamic between them. We could then expect these simulations to be very confined and not in the billions like Elon Musk proposed. I know these scenarios are very speculative, but they have to be because there is no way we can truly answer the simulation hypothesis with certainty. All we can do is speculate according to what we already know about our world. But in conclusion, I would like to propose the two major factors that would indicate that we are not being simulated. One is that we don't know if consciousness identical to how we are experiencing it is even possible to simulate. And two, even if it is possible, it wouldn't necessarily follow that a post-human civilization would produce such simulations where the inhabitants inside of it are conscious, because regardless of what the purpose the simulation might serve, whether it be for entertainment, pleasure, or to conduct experiments, these purposes would still be attainable without having the inhabitants inside the simulation be conscious. Making the inhabitants conscious might just result in unnecessary consumption of computer power and also crossing ethical boundaries for no reason at all.